We love you, Lord God, for your greatness. You are so awesome in this place, Lord God. We just want to worship you. We love your presence, Father. Great are you, Lord. Come on, let's sing that tonight. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Come on, let's sing it tonight with your high voice. Great are you, up the name of the Lord. Great are you, Lord. You're holy in this place. Great are you, Lord. Oh, yes. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Oh, we love, we love, we love you, Lord. Great are you, so great, greatly to be praised. Thank you, Father. We bless you, Father. We bless your holy name tonight. Quiero estar en tu presencia. Necesito estar contigo. Necesito amar. Quiero estar en su presencia.
Estar en tu presencia.
Y poderte contemplar.
Y poderte contemplar.
Necesito estar contigo.
Necesito estar contigo.
Necesito adorar. Dame de beber de tu manantial. Dame de beber. Necesito estar en su presencia y poderte contemplar. Necesito estar contigo. Necesito estar contigo.
Necesito estar contigo.
Necesito adorar.
Necesito adorar.
Dame de beber de tu manantial. presencia, mi rey. Dame de beber, dame de beber de tu manantial. Dame de beber, necesito.
Aquí esta noche quieres más de Jesucristo. Aleluya. We want more Jesus. Queremos más. The Bible says in Matthew 5 and verse 6, or maybe it's verse 7, those that hunger, those that thirst for righteousness, they shall be filled. We know that God, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, is no tease. He's not just going to give you just a little bit. He's going to make sure you have everything you need. When he said in the last days, I'm going to pour out my spirit, he didn't say half. He said all of his spirit. So I say tonight is a night that we declare we want more for Jesus. Reason why we want more is because we need to do more for him. Hallelujah. The reason why you put gas in your car so that your car can operate and go long distance. And tonight we're here to continue to get filled up, because the journey ahead of faith is going to take us levels. Hallelujah. I said new levels in the name of Jesus. Father, we're here to bless your holy name. You're a great God. How great is our God? He's a great God. I want to do something special tonight. Hallelujah. As we're here at the altar, y'all stay right where you are. God is doing some amazing things right now in that family. We bless the Benavides family. Hallelujah. Phyllis is here, Miss Kim. She is with child. She's actually late, a little bit overdue. So, Dad, I want a chair right here in the middle, and I want a couple of the Abigail ladies to come and surround her with love. Phyllis, if you can, just slowly walk your way this way. Hallelujah. She is to have the baby in a couple of days. She is scheduled to go in there to Jordanton and be scheduled to have the baby. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So she's just slow. We have all night. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Some of the praise team ladies, go surround her right now. Y'all carry an anointing. Sandra, you have miracle babies. Priscilla, you have miracle babies. Lolly, you have miracle babies. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I want y'all to form a circle around her. That's all right. I don't want her to focus on me. I want y'all to form a circle around her. You know, there's things that Phyllis needs. There's things that she needs physically. But before we get to any of that, we know that she needs more than ever the circle of love, the circle of faith, and the circle of sisters who will continue to pray, who will continue to love, who will continue to help in any way possible. So Lord, before we get physical things, like we're going to need Pampers, we're going to need outfits, we're going to need tennis shoes and socks and formula and all that good stuff that made Mighty Evan grow to 20 pounds in a month. Before we get anything physically, let's be personal with the Lord. There's an anointing in this house. I want you to know, Sister Phyllis, that God covers you. God loves you. He loves you. And He's put you in this place. You know, you moved away for a little bit. You went somewhere to forget where, but you went somewhere far out of state. Whatever reason, God brought you back here. And you could have lived anywhere in Catula, but you just lived down the road from the church. And every day I'm blessed to see them walking, going to go get groceries, walking to go get whatever they need to get, they walk. You know, they could sit at home and whine and complain and cry and boo-hoo. They say, you know what? God is our provider. And if it takes a little bit of sacrifice on our end, we'll do it. They'd walk to church, but we graciously go pick them up. One of the little kids drives a convertible car to church that he got for Christmas. Phyllis, I want you to know you're loved. And the sisters are here and you are surrounded with love. So, Miss Kim, however you want to lead it, but just I want y'all personally, you know, don't touch your belly or anything like that. We want to just maybe just stretch our hands and pray right now for her. Hallelujah.
You know, Pastor Mark is absolutely right when he says there's women here that love you. And I think as you've been speaking, you know, a lot of us have felt pressed to bless the baby. Not only to bless in prayer, but to bless materially. So as we can, women, I want you all to ask God, what is your part with this family? And we'll make sure this baby's coming on Friday. So we make sure that when Mama comes home, she's going to have plenty for this little girl. It's a little girl, so we get to have fun. So y'all go ahead and gather around her, and you can touch her belly.
All right.
Father, we thank you for this beautiful child. We declare now that this baby...
Some of the men go stand by Ramsey right there in the back. Some of the men.
Some of is our, chosen.
Our men. Go stand with him.
She'll be anointed. She'll have gifts to sing and to bless others. Father, I thank you that this entire family will represent new beginnings as this baby comes, and miracles will surround this life and this family. Miracles that they didn't even expect. Right now, we declare a home for this family.
Yes.
A miracle home. Right now, we declare a supernatural job. And we thank you that every need, not only for this baby that's coming, but for the entire family, will be met in the name of Jesus.
In the name.
I thank you, Father, that we all draw closer to you. And we all get to be a part of this miracle that's coming.
Yes.
Thank you, Father. And we declare a smooth, easy delivery in the right time. She'll make it to the hospital. and deliver that beautiful baby girl.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. Come on, someone say amen. Hallelujah. Well, what a blessing. Ladies, love on her. Maybe you want to give her your number one day and just say, here, call me if you need anything. You know, Pastor, get on with the church service. Yeah, we a service of love. Roland, I want you to come back up here. You were standing up here by faith, but I strongly sense in my spirit you're not standing for you. Who are you standing for? Now, if you're standing for you, well, praise the Lord. But that's what I sense in my spirit, Roland. Come up here, Roland. I want you to tell me, who are you standing for? Where's Roland? Did he go outside? Did he go to security? He's coming. Right, were you standing to receive, or were you standing for someone else? Hallelujah. When did you have that dream, Michelle? Come, Sister Hilda, stand by Michelle. Hallelujah. Y'all can be seated in the house. Rest your bodies. Word, greater works. Amen. Well, we're in the book of Daniel, and it talked about dreams. Do you think God speaks through dreams? We know He does. Amen. Here, lift y'all's hands. Father, we know that You are the Creator. You're the giver of all things. And Lord, this is a prayer and a desire to see someone come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ, to repent and to be set free and to be saved, to follow in Your footsteps. The scripture says in Acts 16:31 that our entire bloodline shall be saved. So I speak that over the Benavides household in the name of Jesus, that as they continue to seek the Lord first, and all these other things shall be. I see salvation added to this family. And just the beginning with the Father, for there's many who will come to know Jesus in the name of the Lord. So Lord, use their lips to speak love. Use their hearts to show Your light. Use their hands to touch and love as You would touch and love. And order their steps. As Proverbs 3:5-6 says, put our trust in the Lord, our steps are ordered. I bless them. I bless Hilda. I thank You, Lord, that she's the mighty evangelist. Hallelujah. She's living, preaching, testifying, glorify the goodness of our Lord. Hallelujah. Greater works in Jesus' name. Can I have an amen? Amen. I declare it so, church. I declare it so. I declare it so. So let me just do a little teaching right here, a little training for y'all. Now that the Lord has revealed it to you, don't ask Him anymore. Just thank Him now. Thank You, Jesus, for my salvation, for my father-in-law's salvation. Just thank Him for it. Somebody called me for prayer, and they said, I need healing. I said, let's pray. He's a God of health. He's a God of healing. He healed you. Okay, thank you so much. Call me the next day. I need healing. I said, is the same issue? Same. I said, no, we're not going to pray. We're going to thank the Lord for your healing. And I was in here vacuuming today. And I had this little sharp pain right here in my calf. And it goes in and out. And I'm being healed. I know that. Because every time it gets greater, the pain. And so I was vacuuming. I said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I wasn't here boo-hooing, crying. Oh, nobody cared. Oh. Nah, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on. You know, last Wednesday we had 21 people up here. And by faith, we all reached up to receive our miracle. Amen. I got a call from an individual that's here in our church. And they're going to share the testimony later as the Lord would lead throughout our next services. How they were diagnosed with something. And that Thursday, they were at the doctor for the final results. Well, they went Thursday. And the doctor said, just pay the lady at the desk. There's nothing wrong with you. Call me immediately. And I said, let's give God praise. Let's give God the glory. Come on, somebody. Tommy, I got a call today. So bless you and Lewis. Y'all work with the media. And that family's coming, hopefully Saturday, and they're going to come to share their testimony because I said, hey, they may be watching right now. They watch every service. We've had over 1,000 viewers this week. Come on, somebody. Thank you, Father. Her husband was in a different room. She was on her couch watching Living Faith Church last Wednesday. She saw everybody here receiving their healing. She said, so-and-so, calling her husband. They're praying for healing. His legs were swollen. They're praying for healing. Believe for your healing. She's there looking at the television. I'm with you, Pastor Mark. I'm with you, praise team. I'm with you, prayer warriors. She's talking to the TV. She's like a crazy woman. Anybody crazy in here that will talk to your TV? If there's faith, I talk to it all the time. Her husband came out the room. My legs are not swollen no more. She's going to come Saturday, hopefully, to share her testimony. That evening, she knew it very well. She said, I saw Roland give the testimony about how God provided for him. He was, you know, kind of, you know, asking God, and he was firm on his faith, and God did a supernatural miracle for him financially. You heard, remember that testimony? At the end of the service, we said, then don't be surprised that check's in the mail. Come on. And I don't say that just to say something. I say it because when I feel the unction in my spirit, I release it. Well, she's sitting on her couch. Did I receive it in the name of Jesus? Well, just yesterday, which was Tuesday, she goes to her mailbox and she opens up her mailbox. And there's a large check in her mail. She wasn't expecting it. It followed and found her. And I said, sister, you got to share that testimony because that encourages us and it builds our faith to know that God is a God of promises. Well, Pastor, there was no check in my mailbox. There's not going to be no check with that attitude. Come on. And don't just believe for a check. Believe God that you're going to be faithful with what he gives you. Come on. And honor him. So we gave God all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. And the day that family brings that testimony, you're going to remember this. Because when there's faith alive, I know the hand of God is stirred to move among the believers. Hallelujah. And it's here tonight. Here, just lift your hand. Levanta sus manos. Just lift your hands. And I say, receive in the name of Jesus. Receive in the name of Jesus. I say, receive in the name of Jesus. Now we just thank him for it. Lord, thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's do it together. Gracias, Padre. Gracias. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for my miracles. Thank you for my healing. Thank you for my restoration. Thank you for revival in Cotulla. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Gracias, Padre. Gracias. Thank you, Lord. Very personal. I had a lot of happy birthday wishes. I mean, it was a lot. My phone expired because it had too many ding, 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 dings. And I told my wife, because someone told me, just do a general thanks everyone for wishing me a happy birthday. I said, no, I want to tell everybody that texts me or called me, or I'm going to say thank you, blessings, or whatever. Do my best. And it took me about 2 hours to do it. Why would you spend 2 hours and do that? You know why? Because should I make next year, I want them to say happy birthday again. So when we're blessed, we ought to say thank you. Because when we say thank you, you know Jesus makes record. Oh, let's check the record book of the miracles. Yeah. Oh, but he never said thank you. He never gave you glory, God. Oh, he's thanking us for a healing right now, but the other miracle, he never gave you glory. Come on, somebody. But my grace is sufficient. Give it to him, son. Okay. And you receive it till you receive the revelation that all things belong to him. We ought to be grateful for everything we have. You know a song, Lewis, of thanks? English, Spanish? Something that says, te doy las gracias. No, that was a Marcus Witt CD, right? I was listening to. Let me see here. Hallelujah. Just want to say thank you. There you go. Or something like that. Yeah. I want this to be a Thanksgiving night. Come on. Let's just spend a couple of more moments in his presence, thanking him. Hallelujah.
gracias, mi Señor.
Hallelujah. We give you praise. And we give you all the glory, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Well, let's just hear why are we thankful. I'm going to come to you. But let's just hear why are we thankful, Marky, and we'll just go Benito, Pastor Lewis, and why are you thankful?
I'm thankful for having a loving community.
A loving community, praise the Lord. Benito? Hallelujah. What a blessing. Lewis?
I thank you for his anointing.
His anointing.
I'm thankful for his mercy. For opportunities.
Amen.
I'm thankful for the blessing of the job that God blessed me with.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. School and family. Praise the Lord. She's thankful for living faith. Anybody else? Just say it out loud where you are. To serve Him. Guidance. Love, grace, our provider, loves you just the way you are. Amen. What a blessing. What a blessing. What a blessing. Sister Anna's in the house. Hallelujah. What a blessing. Anyone else before we start the word of the Lord? Hermana Olivia. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. What a blessing. What a blessing. What a blessing. Well, Lord, we bless you today. We thank you for what you're doing and what you continue to do in living faith and around the world. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, well, let's get ready for the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. God is good. Let's turn to Daniel chapter 3. El libro de Daniel, capítulo 3, tarde, noche, how do you say evening? Tarde, all right. Praise the Lord. Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3. We're going to be reading here, starting with verse number 19. Verse number 19. Daniel chapter 3, starting with verse number 19. Then Nebuchadnezzar was full of fury. The expression on his face changed toward Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He spoke and commanded that they heat the furnace 7 times more than it was usually heated. And he commanded certain mighty men of valor who were in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them into the burning fiery furnace. These men were bound in their coats, trousers, turbans, these other garments, and were cast into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Therefore, because the king's command was very urgent and the furnace was exceedingly hot, the flame of the fire killed those men who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, fell down, bound into the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Then King Nebuchadnezzar was astonished as he rose in haste and spoke, saying to his counselors, "Did we not cast three men bound in the midst of the fire?" They answered and said to the king, "Yes, true, O king." The king said, "Look, I see four, and they are loose, and they are walking in the midst of the fire, and they are not hurt, and they are not even singed. Their hair is not singed. They don't smell like smoke. And the fourth man there looks like the Son of God." Amen and amen. We 2 weeks spoke about how God's people, now in reference to Daniel chapter 3 with these three Hebrew boys, God's people are persecuted. Now, when we read the word persecuted, what comes to mind? When we hear the word persecuted, what comes to our mind? We're being what? Sure, punished, put down, judged, criticized, brought low, pushed down, stepped on, sure. Persecution. Here are these three boys, not just feeling it, but enduring it. They didn't just step into a room and they saw everybody look at them and they felt the heat. But the actual heat was in physical form and it was right there before them. King Nebuchadnezzar was known. If you didn't do it his way, it's either his way or the highway. The highway was not a highway, it was your destination. And these boys knew that. But before they could be pushed around, shoved around, pushed down, come on, criticized, judged, neglected, in any of those other ways, they had to determine within themselves that they would not compromise, fall into this trap like everyone else fell. So what's going on in their life, and what's going on in their environment right now? Everybody's bowing. Everybody's doing it. And these boys are standing strong. So what happens when we stand out? We're going to be recognized, right? We become different, right? We're not like the other ones, so we become different now. And so the same people that they were running with, the Chaldeans, the same priests, the same intelligent overseers that were running with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who were in the same classes, come on, let's say in the same church, let's say in the same environment at school or in the same environment at work, you're at the same levels, but yet because we're standing up, we're different, we're not doing what they say to do or falling the way they're falling, so now we are different. Because they were different, they didn't like different. They didn't like change. Just obey the man. Do what he says. Save your life. Then go back to your own business. But see, it wasn't business as usual that day. When they heard all the music, they knew that they were having to do and make a decision. either bow and save your life or stand and lose your life. A or B? Bow, save your life. B, stand, lose your life. Very quickly, people start circling A. Come on. Save my life. But see, these boys had a stronger relationship with the Lord. They could not deny their God. God's Spirit ran through them. Come on. They could not deny Him. They spent too much time with God that God has shown Himself to them in great and mighty ways. They could not deny that just for the sake of their temporary life. Now again, these are young people. In the midst of all these haters. And they got a choice to make. Go with the flow. Or go against the flow. I like watching the Discovery Channel. Y'all watch Net Geo Wild, anybody? Discovery Channel. I like seeing it. I like when the lions come out. I especially love when it's feeding time for the lions. I was seeing a show the other night, and it was about fish. And specifically the salmon. Salmon is a very protein dish, cooked right. Over a cedar plank with some garlic butter. A real good fish, high in protein, good for you too, cooked right, no butter, a lot of lemon, over cedar plank. You know, salmon lures, they don't go with the flow, huh? Wait a minute, it's easy to go with the flow. The river's already taking you where you need to go. It's easy. Get in line and just go with the flow. Just ride the wave. You mean we don't got to do no work? No, just go with the flow. Everybody's doing it. Just get in line and just go with the flow, and the flow will take you where you need to go. Salmon say, well, that's second best. I don't want second best. I want what's the best. Oh, but it's going to cost you something. You're going to have to go between every fish as go with the flow. You're going to have to go and get beat up by the waves. Uh-oh. You're going to have to go through it. You're going to get scratches because rocks are going to be flying through you. You're going to be weaving through weeds. And it's too much. Oh, and don't let me forget to tell you that you're also going to have to jump. Fish don't jump. Oh, they fly. Salmon do. Wait a minute. What do you mean we're going to have to jump? Yep. You're not only going to have to go against the flow, the current, and fight everything that's right there in front of you. Why would you even do that? Just go with the flow. Bow. Come on. Accept your disease. By going with the flow, you're accepting those areas in your life. But if you go against the flow, that's not my disease. That's not my sickness. No, that's not what God promised me. He promised me this. So is it going to be easy going upstream? No. Because you know what? I felt this pain already for 3 weeks. It ain't easy. But I'm not going with the flow and just saying, well, I guess this is the way I'm going to live now my entire life. Yeah, right. I'd be a bad example. I started to believe God would say this, okay, let me just take the anointing away from Pastor Mark because he settled with the flow when I've called you to go upstream. So then the salmon's at the point where they have to jump, right? Uh-oh. They got to jump to get to a higher what? Level. Oh, but don't let me tell. I need to tell you, when you jump, watch out. What do I need to watch out for? The teeth of the bears. What? Bear teeth? Oh, yeah. Especially the mama bears. I tell that story to my daughter, Bella. And those fangs are long. They're vicious. Sounds like some wolves I've met in church. Sounds like some people I know. I got to jump through the mouths of the bears. But what if I don't make it? But what if you do? Huh? Pastor, the odds are really, no, what if you do make it? What if you do make it? Now, on Net Geo Wild, some of the famine landed in the mouths of the bears. But more than the ones landed in the mouths of the bears, I saw a whole lot more making it. Come on. You won't get there unless you jump. Peter would have never met Jesus unless he got out that boat. Come on, somebody. He would have never fell into that water and yell and say, help me, Jesus, if he wouldn't have stepped out. Come on. The disciples would have died in their fear if they would have never went to Jesus and woke him up and say, don't you care, we perish. Jesus steps out the boat and says, peace, be still. You see, we'll really never know what the Lord has for us until we go for it, until we try, until we do our very best to take that step of faith. See, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they really, they said, we will not bow. There's no need to answer you on this matter. I'm not going to bow to you. God will save us from your hand, Nebuchadnezzar. But if he doesn't, so what does that tell you and me? These boys were standing even, come on, even in some question. Come on. They were still standing even in the midst of God's going to save us from your hand. But even if he doesn't save us and we die in the fire, want you to know and everybody here know that we're not going to bow to some carved image, even if it's made out of gold. We're just not going to do it. So they're willing to lay down their life because of their relationship with their God. Those salmon were willing to lay up their life for the sake of what they knew what was better at a higher level. There's going to be obstacles in our walk with God that we're going to have to go through. There's going to be hurdles that we have to jump. And yeah, some of us are going to scratch our knees and fall and scrape and all, but the good thing about having a church family is that you have people around you that are not just running with you, but you also have people on the sidelines that have already ran that race. Come on. Have already jumped that hurdle. Come on. And are saying, come on, you can do it. I believe it. Get back up. Get back up. No. Don't stop. Keep on going. Come on. Yeah, just one more. Come on. Keep it going. Keep it going. Keep it going. Keep it going. Well, in the book of Daniel chapter 3, Daniel was not even discovered in that one chapter. Daniel would be considered their mentor, their teacher, their quarterback. They were always either on the sidelines and, yeah, we'll back you up, Daniel. Whatever you say, we're with you. Kind of like riding his coattail. But then when they split and they began to work in separate areas, Daniel's no longer in the picture. So here's Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And that's really when the heat gets hotter. Come on. The heat's not on when you're at church. Come on. The heat's not on when you're blessed and just really not going through anything right. Heat's not on. But when you're going through some things, come on. The heat starts turning up. That's really where we know who we are, why we are, what God wants to do through us. If I had an orange here, I said that the other day, and if I were to squeeze that orange, wring that orange out, apple juice ain't going to come out of that orange. What's going to come out of that orange? Orange juice. So whatever's on the inside of us as believers, when the pressure's put on, it's going to come out. You understand? So when we get some pressure in our life, in our walk with God, what is coming out? Because what comes out is what we worship. Did you hear that, church? What we say is what we bow to. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were persecuted. But they were not just persecuted. My second point to you today is that Daniel wrote this incredible chapter to show us that God's people aren't only persecuted, but they're also preserved. Amen? They're preserved. Now, when we say the word preserved, what does that mean? Huh? Grandma Annie preserves pears. What does that mean to preserve? Put aside. Come on, we got a lot of smart people in the church. Come on now. You preserve it. Because you, in other words, you guard it, you protect it. You want it to last, right? Preserve it. So God's people are not just a persecuted people, because that's the heat of the fire. But we are also a preserved people. God protects us in so many areas. My wife said it this way: God does more for us than we don't know about than what we do know about. We are a preserved people. These three Hebrew boys were cast into what? The fire. We just read that there were mighty men of valor who were escorting these boys into the fire. Now, this fire wasn't just a fire. Come on. This fire wasn't to cook medium well steaks. This fire was to cook well done steaks. It was hot. Estaba muy caliente el fuego. The scripture says, as we read it, that they bound them. Now, do this with me. Do this like this, like if you're bound. You have things tied. You can't really do much if you're bound, right? You're kind of limited, right? I'm limited to what I can do if I'm tied down. Now, they didn't go up there just in their, they didn't go there with their summer clothes, shorts, and a tank top. They went with all their garments. Come on. You heard it. Their trousers, their turbans, their coats, and other garments. Now, why would people who are going into a fiery furnace, it's already hot, why would you add more weight to your life if you're already going somewhere to be burned? You know, Nebuchadnezzar was so mad that he didn't want 1 ounce of material that they owned in his kingdom. He took everything they owned, because remember, they were captive from Babylon. I mean, from Judah to Babylon. Everything they owned, he put it on them. He bound them, or binded them. And he chose his best warriors, his strongest, his elite warriors, to take these boys, come on, these young men who were already limited. They couldn't do much. They were covered in their garments. The furnace was hot. And we know they had to climb up because they fell in. So they were climbing up. And as they were climbing up, bound. What did God do? What does the Bible say? Therefore, because the king's command, verse 22, was urgent, and the furnace was exceedingly hot, the flame of the fire killed those men who took up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Church, what is binding us from truly worshiping God? Sometimes we see the furnace and we think, man, they must have been really bad. God has them in the furnace, and man, they must have really been in some sin. Man, they're going through some trials. Woo, I'm glad I'm not there with them. I'm glad I'm not even near them. Sometimes we look at the furnace as a downfall. But here for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the furnace was more than torture. It was an area to be triumphant. Come on, church. They carried them, they took them bound up to the fiery furnace, and the Bible says the people that took them burned up. Wait a minute. The person on my right and the person on my left that bound me, that are taking me where I'm going to fall into, they burned up. Well, what about me? What about Shadrach, Meshach, and why didn't they get burned? Why? I mean, what's the difference? The heat burned my neighbor on my right. The heat burned my neighbor on my left. And I'm right here. There's no difference. Why didn't the heat burn me? Because God preserves his people. We're preserved. We have a special garment. Come on. It's fireproof. Amen? It's fireproof. We don't look at a furnace. We don't look at it as a trial. Ay, ando por las pruebas. Ay, ando por los luches. Ay, no aguanto. No, don't see it like that. Praise God. Because at the end of my fiery furnace, I know I will be preserved. God will do something in me. I'll become stronger through it. If we look at our furnace as torture, we'll never triumph over the areas of our lives. I want you to hear this. There were levels too. The worship began to play, Lewis, all the instruments. Woo! Everybody started to bow at that golden image. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego standing tall. That was one level of heat. Their ears were red. They felt it. It's thick. Then they got told on. Bunch of tattletales, tell on them. Bunch of haters, shake those haters off. Hating on them. You know, you told us all to bow at your image, but they didn't bow. What are you going to do to them? Sounds like some of my children. Tending on each other. And then when I'm disciplining them, oh yeah, I discipline them. The child who told is there on the door, making sure I do what I say. So here are those other haters telling Nebuchadnezzar, what you gonna do? They're making you look bad. They're not obeying your word. They're the ones that you put over as leaders, and they're not obeying your word. Second furnace comes. Come on, somebody. And the heat of Nebuchadnezzar rises and says, is this true? I bring you here to lead. You're smarter than all my other counselors, and here you are not obeying my word. What's going on with you? I'm gonna give you another chance. When you hear the music, you better bow. If not, you're going to burn. Third furnace, what they going to say about that? Come on, somebody. What do we say when we receive things like that? Are we going to bow and say, okay, I'll give in to your threats? Come on. I'll just surrender and just say, well, I guess this was God's will. Come on. Well, I guess this is really what God wants for my ministry in life, because maybe I'll be a testimony through my furnace and my trial and just stay and die in that. No, it's not what God wants. So they stood up and they said, we have nothing to tell you, Nebuchadnezzar. God will save us from your hand. If he doesn't, we're still not going to bow. And the furnace was lit. Nebuchadnezzar was lit. The Bible says his whole face changed. Come on. You ever see somebody get mad? Woo! Well, yes, get in this stool. Who are you? Because now they are no longer in the private session with Nebuchadnezzar. They are now telling him in front of his face, among the public people, we're not going to bow. We rather burn and not bow. In other words, that furnace is no threat to us. You are no threat to us. That issue, that situation is not a threat to me, because I know I have the victor in me. Come on. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. See, they knew that already. And they had to make a decision. So when he said, crank up that furnace, I want these guys cooked well done. And I want you to grab everything they own and burn it too. See, when the devil heats up the fire, he wants every bit of you consumed. That's why you don't just feel the heat. Your wife feels it. Your children feel it. Come on. Your job, your boss might feel it when you're in the heat. Come on. Your friends feel it. Come on. Everyone that's close to you feels the heat if you let them feel the heat. They'll know you're going through something just by your expressions, just by your behavior, just by your attitudes, just by your way of speaking. They'll know. Someone said the other day, well, how do they know I'm going through? Well, look at you. I pulled out my phone, I put on the picture, and I put it on the reverse. Look at your face. Nobody talking about you. You telling everybody what's going on in your life. By the way you look. You look defeated. You look burdened. You look sorrow. Well, Pastor, I am. Okay. You are now. Let's fix it. Come on. Don't focus on the furnace as a torture. Focus on the furnace as something I can triumph over. And I'll end with this. The reason why God preserves his people is because God, Jesus, by his Spirit, is an ever-present God. Amen? The Bible says he'll never what? Nunca nos dejará. He'll never leave us, nor will he forsake us. God is an ever-present God. He's there. Someone say he's there. He's there. The Bible says he is Shama, the God who is always there. Jesus looked at his disciples in Matthew 28. He said, and lo, I will be with you even to the end of this world. Amen. Why are we knowing that we are a preserved people? Because we serve an ever-present God. I'm not having to think, is God here for me? I know God's here for me. I'm not having to believe, will God hear me? I know he hears me. I'm not having to wonder, oh, is my worship entering into the throne room of God? I know when I worship, I am lifting up an aroma to God, and God smells it, and God knows where I'm at. God knows what I need, and God's hand is not short to give us exactly what we need. Come on. He's an ever-present God. He'll never leave me, nor will he forsake. He wakes up with me. He goes to bed with me. He wakes up with me. He goes to bed with me. If I'm on the mountain, he's there with me. If I'm walking through a valley, he's there with me. If I'm burning in a fiery furnace, he's there with me. He'll never leave me, nor will he ever forsake me. The reason why people feel that God has left them, it's not because God moved. We moved. We moved back home. We settled. We bowed and worshiped sickness and disease, poverty and unsuccessful living. We bow down to it and say, oh, this is my life. This is the way I live. My daddy lived like that. My mama lived like that. I guess I'm going. I refuse. My parents showed me a great life, a life of faith. But I refuse to stay at their level. Come on. And I train my children to refuse to stay at the level I'm leaving them as a legacy. We have to continue to grow in God. Church, there's no more time for silliness. There's no more time for playing. Don't play me as a pastor. Don't play me as a public servant. Don't play God's people. Don't play God's church. Don't play around with God. Many are called, but a few will be chosen. And I strongly believe that if we can walk through a fiery furnace, a furnace of hate, a furnace of negative, a furnace of sickness and disease, a furnace of ridicule, of persecution, any kind of divorce is a furnace, separation is a furnace, you can just go on and on. Children can sometimes be a furnace that we're feeling in our lives. Just anything in life that causes a pressure in us is a furnace. But if we view that furnace as a torture, then we are defeated. But if we view that furnace as something I can go and triumph with God, no longer do I see that furnace as something that's bad for me, but I welcome it and I say, come on. With God, all things are possible. Hallelujah. Come on, praise team. Let's get up here. Praise the Lord. See, I even feel stronger on my leg. Praise the Lord, Miss Kim. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. God is good. He's good all the time. Amen. We're going to sow a seed tonight. We're going to bless our outreach. Our outreach is this Saturday. And we are inviting everybody to come be with us. Everybody. It's an Abigail and a Master's Commission. Both men and women of the Lord. Amen. It's a Bible time, a Bible fellowship. We're going to come and we're going to fellowship in God's Word. We're going to sing songs of praise, hear some testimonies, sharpen each other. We're going to embrace prayer and just see mighty miracles. Visitors are going to be coming. Come on. You're going to be inviting all your neighbors. You're going to go to the hotels and invite every oil worker. Come on, somebody. You're going to go to the stores and help Pastor Katula. Come on, somebody. And you're going to invite people to come. We're going to feed them afterwards. Praise the Lord. It's going to be a great meal. We got a specialty soup and a good dish that's going to be with us that day. And so that's going to be Saturday. And we want everyone to be here 10 a.m. And so tonight we are thanking you, helping us as a ministry provide for our community and be a blessing and put a seed into their life. Amen. And so let's sow a seed tonight. Can we all stand? Amen. Can we sow a seed? Ushers will help us. Let's sow a seed tonight and let's believe God for the best in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right. Well, let's come sow. Let's come thank the Lord and let's bless His holy name. Thank you, Jesus.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endureth forever.
God sees, God is all. Hallelujah. To God be the glory. Father, we thank you for the seed sown. We thank you, Lord, for the seed sown. We need to hear, reach over to that container right there and let's lift it up to Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for the seed sown. We lift it up to you, Lord. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I thank you, Lord, for every tithe, every giver. We obey and trust in you, Father. We trust in you. We obey you, Lord. Your kingdom come. Your will be done. I declare this seed blessed. Oh, reaching. Souls changed, rearranged in the name of Jesus. And everyone said amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, we're going to pray for Phyllis. Friday, have a baby. Praise the Lord. And we're going to pray for Pepe. And we're declaring in the name of Jesus a miracle for you, sir. They're watching live right now. Junior, Megan, Rosalinda, the entire family. We're trusting. And we're believing with you. God, all things are possible. Don't settle, don't bow. God preserves his people. And I'm believing, God, the anointing that's here right now is being transferred right now. So lift your hands, Junior. People, lift your hands from your hospital room to this altar. I declare God's working miracle power is now in the name of Jesus. So we declare and we thank you, Lord, for your miraculous. miraculous healing and the testimony through the fire. We come and become triumphant in the name of Jesus. Can I have an amen?
Amen.
Miss Kim, we got a miracle report for Israel. Share with us real quick that miracle report. Amen. Praise the Lord. Woo. Well, our prayers on Sunday and the entire pastors and nations that were praying, we just continue to pray the peace of Jerusalem. We declare the good news and the gospel to be preached to every Jew in the name of Jesus. Oh, what great reports. Hallelujah. Well, church is over, but church is not over. Amen? Because you are the church, and where you are, He's with you. So go and spread the love of the Lord Jesus Christ to our world. I call you blessed. God bless you. Have a good night. We'll see you Sunday or Saturday if you can be with us, 10 a.m. Blessings, everybody. Hallelujah.
Every step that I take, every move that I